Arriving in Sweden, I quickly discovered this country has an abundance of ingredients from the forest. Berries, mushrooms, and game. And my boar burritos is a fantastic way to celebrate these flavors. I'm gonna start off making a spice blend. So I've got some onion powder, salt, some ground allspice, flavor that pops up a lot in Swedish food. White pepper, give that a little mix. And then you want to get your boar shoulder, or if you can't get wild boar, just use pork. Pop your spice mix on top and then give it a good massage. A little bit of oil, and when you feel it's nice and hot, then put the pork in or your boar in. You want to sear the meat to lock in the flavors. When you've got a bit of a golden crust, you can turn the meat over. Once the meat is seared, I'm gonna add some hot chicken stock. Be a bit careful when you add your stock because it does have the tendency of splashing back. Turn the heat down, a few sprigs of thyme. Cover it and let the magic happen. Basically, you just need to let it simmer until the meat falls away.
That's roughly 1.5 hours.
So these boar burritos are loosely inspired by traditional burritos, but I'm using Swedish ingredients. Firstly, some horseradish. I'm gonna add some lovely heat to my sour cream. I'm quite generous with my horseradish because I like it really spicy. I'm gonna add a bit of salt. Horseradish cream done. Got some romaine lettuce here. Roughly chop this up. So now let's check on the meat. Have a look. I'll turn it off the heat. Just be careful, it's a bit hot at this point, so you might want to let it cool down a couple minutes before you start shredding. Grab two forks, and then you just need to shred it. It should be really easy to do because the meat is quite literally falling apart. This is a great dish to do if you're entertaining quite a few people because you can prep a lot of things in advance and you can just put it all on the table and everybody just helps themselves. One Swedish tradition I discovered from living here in Sweden, which I thought was a bit unusual, was Taco Fridays. It's this thing that Swedes love to eat tacos on Friday. It's a bit like how in England they love to have a curry on Friday. To stop the meat from drying out, I'm just gonna add a couple of ladles of stock. I've warmed up some Swedish flatbread in the oven. If you can't get hold of Swedish flatbread, tortillas will work. I have some Swedish brown beans here. So they're slightly sweet, a little bit spicy with cinnamon and allspice, but you could use a tin of kidney beans warmed up, that would work. Just need to plate it up. Grab a flatbread. Now it's all about just building your own burrito. Some horseradish sour cream. There's no particular way of doing this. Anyway or anyway. Beans, some shredded meat, a little bit of salad, best of bottom cheese, or you could use mature cheddar. A few pink pickled onions. The hardest part is wrapping it up, so key with this is not to put too much in it, otherwise the bread's never gonna wrap around all the filling. Or it's, better said, it's not gonna fit in the mouth. I couldn't think of a better way of eating boar. If there's one thing you could always find in a Swedish kitchen, it has to be knäckebröd, Swedish crisp bread. My favorite kind is one made with rye and sourdough. I've got some lovely rye flour here. Plain flour.
This balances out the heaviness from the rye flour.
A teaspoon of instant yeast. And then here I have dried sourdough starter. And the reason I'm using it is for the flavor. It makes it a little bit more complex, a bit more interesting. Teaspoon of salt, about a tablespoon of sugar. And then I want to combine everything together. And then I'm going to add some very soft butter. And finally, some buttermilk. You just want to bring everything together. Press the dough. Right, it's coming together really nicely. Press it into a ball. Now I'm gonna pop it in a clean bowl. A little bit of oil in there so it doesn't stick. Cover it up with some cling film. and then let it rest for about an hour and a half in a warm spot. The dough's been resting. The reason you want to let your dough rest is that it'll make it easier to roll out. If you roll it out straight away, the gluten is developed and it's just rubbery, bouncy. Dust your work surface and then roll it out. It doesn't really matter if it's not perfect or round shape. I quite like it when it's a bit rustic looking. Traditionally, knäckebröd are about record size and they have a hole cut out in the middle, and I always wondered what that hole was. And apparently, it's from hanging them up on a pole from the ceiling. Okay, and now I've got this, it's not for massaging your back. It's actually a rolling pin to prick the dough. But if you don't have that, you can just use a fork. And what that does is it helps keep the knäckebröd flat. I'm gonna flip it over, roll the other side, and then that goes into the oven. So you know when your knäckebröd is done, when you have these lovely kind of slightly burnt brown edges, and it should feel crisp. I think the best way to eat knäckebröd is to keep it really simple. A few toppings, that's all you need. A little bit of cream cheese. Then I have some pink pickled onions. I always have these in the fridge.
To make your own pink pickled onions, bring 400 milliliters of water, 300 milliliters of vinegar, 100 grams of sugar, 30 grams of salt, and 20 juniper berries to the boil. Stir and leave to cool before adding 750 grams of sliced onions. Store in a sterilized jar.
Some Swedish olives. Oh, they're actually little green unripe plums. A little spruce oil. Swedish knäckebröd, the simplest way to add a little Swedish touch to your kitchen.